The entrance antiphon, Christ, having risen from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer will have dominion over him. Alleluia. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My sisters and brothers, good morning. Welcome to the Cathedral Basilica of the Immaculate Conception, and welcome to this pre-recorded Mass for Monday of the second week of Easter. My sisters and brothers, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves for these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that we who have been renewed by paschal remedies, transcending the likeness of our earthly parentage, may be transformed in the image of our heavenly Maker. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Please be seated as we listen to the Word of God. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. After their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported what the chief priests and elders had told them. And when they heard it, they raised their voices to God with one accord and said, "Sovereign Lord, maker of heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, you said by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of our father David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples entertain folly? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the princes gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed. Indeed, they gathered in this city against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. Herod and Pontius Pilate gathered with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel to do what your hand and your will had long ago planned to take place. And now, Lord, take note of their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with all the boldness as you stretch forth your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." As they prayed, the place where they gathered shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. The word of the Lord. Our responsorial psalm, "Blessed are all who take refuge in the Lord." Blessed are all. Why do the nations rage and the people utter folly? The kings of the earth rise up and princes conspire together against the Lord and against his anointed. Let us break their fetters and cast their bonds from us. Blessed are all who take refuge in the Lord. He who is throned in heaven laughs. The Lord derides them. Then in anger he speaks to them. He terrifies them in his wrath. I myself have set up my king on Zion, my holy mountain. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. Blessed are all who take refuge in the Lord. The Lord said to me, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for an inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall rule them with an iron rod. You shall shatter them like an earthen dish." Blessed are all who take refuge. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. If then you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. There was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. He came to Jesus at night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you are doing unless God is with him." Jesus answered and said to him, "Amen, amen, I say to you, unless one is born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man once grown old be born again? Surely he cannot re-enter his mother's womb and be born again, can he?" Jesus answered, "Amen, amen, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. What is born of flesh is flesh, and what is born of spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed that I told you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it will, and you can hear the sounds it makes, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, my sisters and brothers, once again, good morning. Enable your servants to speak your word. It's a beautiful line in the first reading, and it really summarizes what we see, what we hear in the first reading, what we hear in the responsorial psalm, and what we hear in the gospel. Because what ultimately Peter is saying is that through the gift of the Holy Spirit, enable us, whoever we are, to speak the words of God. And what we see over the last week and a half now, since Easter Sunday, through the Acts of the Apostles, have been the trials and the travails of Peter and John. We've seen them both talk to the Jews about the need for their conversion and repentance. We've seen them baptize 3,000 people. We've seen them get arrested. We have seen them questioned by the elders of the temple, and basically them talk back to him in a pretty direct and, quite frankly, sarcastic way. And then the elders kind of say, "What do we do with them? The people are seeing the miracles that they're doing. How can we repress this?" And so then they let them go and basically say, "Don't do that again." And so now Peter and John are back home, and they're telling the people what they were told by the chief priests. And what's interesting about this is that we are seeing in spades right now the fact that the Old Testament prefigures the New Testament. The fact here that we have Peter quoting David with, "Why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples entertain folly? The kings of the earth took their stand and the princes gathered against their Lord and against his anointed." And so he's reminding them that this happened in the past, and that these kings came along and destroyed the ancient kingdom of Israel. And part of it was through the hands of the descendants of David that had gone bad. And so now what we see is this cycle repeating itself, because we now have God's servant Jesus, who has come from on high to save God's holy people, and the leaders of this time, the quote-unquote kings, have not only murdered him, but they're trying to repress his memory. They're living in a world of revisionist history, is what you and I would call it today, right? So what we see is that Peter is saying, "God, take note of what's going on. Take note, but enable us to speak your word. Give us that power. Give us that grace." Because it says, as they prayed, the place where they gathered shook, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, how are they able to speak the word of God? It's through the power of the Holy Spirit within them. Jesus is ascended into heaven. The apostles, in Luke's Acts of the Apostles, are now out on mission, and they are being guided by the Holy Spirit. And it's that Holy Spirit that in each one of these situations inspires them to say what needs to be said to those to whom they are speaking. Now, what does that require? That requires an inner peace and an inner silence. And that's the same thing that you and I need when as we listen to the guidance of the Holy Spirit in our lives, because the Holy Spirit became part of our life through the gift of our baptism, and grew during the sacrament of Eucharist, and grew even more in the sacrament of Confirmation. But it's that Holy Spirit that's going to guide us and allow us to be the vessel through whom God works with His people. And who are God's people now? Everyone. Everyone in the world are His people, and God wants to work through us to affect their lives, to bring them to conversion, to bring them to repentance, and to bring them to seek forgiveness. So this reading is really setting the stage for all of that in a wonderful way. And then after the place shook, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they continued to speak the word of God with boldness. And so we see that, in fact, the Holy Spirit was active and alive within them. We see this reflected also in the responsorial psalm number 2. And again, it's talking about, why do the nations rage and the people utter folly? The kings rise up. So again, the words that are used in Psalm 2 are reflecting what David said in times of old, and how the leaders come to destroy God's people. But then what we have is then God saying in this psalm that he who is throned in the heavens laughs, and I myself have set up my king on Zion, my holy mountain, and I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. And you are my son, and this day I have begotten you. And so he's reminding them that the psalmist is, that there is a greater power at work here. No matter what the earthly forces are that come against you, the heavenly forces will come to rescue you. Well, isn't that true today too? There's a lot of forces in this world against us right now. And yet it's the Lord that's coming to rescue us. And we see this even in the coronavirus right now, with all the suffering, the sickness, the death, the anxiety, the depression, all of the things that are going on right now. But it's the Lord that is working through others to help others and to pull them through all of this and to allow them to lead with kindness, which is what the world needs right now. So we see all of that of the Old Testament coming alive in the time of Jesus and his apostles. Now, when we get to the gospel, we have the first of the meetings with Nicodemus. And Nicodemus was an interesting individual. And my sense is that he's a lot more like us than we ever want to realize. Jesus has, the New Testament, the Gospels, have three encounters with Nicodemus. This is the first one, where Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the dark of night. He comes in the darkness of a lack of faith to the one who is the light of the world. Okay. That's what this is all about. But then the next time we see Nicodemus is what we heard last week on Holy Thursday in the Passion, when Nicodemus spoke up in the trial of Jesus to say, you know, what do we really have against this man? So Nicodemus is sort of starting to come out of the shadows. And then Nicodemus is one of the people who comes to take Jesus down from the cross and bury him. And so he's the one that asks for the body of Jesus. And so we see this growing of faith from this darkness of lack of faith within Nicodemus to this growing of faith now. And so we begin now this catechesis, if you will, of Nicodemus. Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you're doing unless God is with him. But then what Jesus says as he invites Nicodemus to conversion is, he says, unless one is born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And then he says, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now remember, one of the beautiful things about Jesus and his public ministry and his life on earth is that he didn't do anything in his humanity he doesn't ask us to do now in our humanity. And Jesus went to John the Baptist to be baptized. Jesus is the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity. He didn't need to be baptized. He didn't need to be claimed for God. He didn't need to have baptism to have the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was part of him. But what he did is he modeled for us what true baptism is. It's water, the baptismal font, and it's the Holy Spirit. That's why the Catholic Church recognizes the baptism of 26 religions, as long as it is a Trinitarian baptism. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So it's the act of pouring the water three times, and it's in the evoking of the Trinity that makes that baptism valid. And of course, that baptism of Jesus was valid because the water was there, and Jesus was the Trinity. Okay? So, he's telling Nicodemus that you need to be baptized of water and the Spirit. And so he's beginning his catechesis, which is a catechesis not only for Nicodemus, but for all of his followers. That's why last week, when Peter was out preaching to the crowds and 3,000 were baptized, we begin to see not only the power of the word of Jesus Christ that he was proclaiming in the gospel, but then also we see that the power of that word goes out and it comes back with fruit. And the fruit was the conversion of 3,000 people. But then he tells us about the mystery of the Holy Spirit. The wind blows where it will, and you can hear the sound it makes, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit acts within each of us differently. But we need to have that interior peace to hear him. But for each one of us, he works differently. But what we do know is exactly what we heard in the first reading, is that the Holy Spirit acting within us will enable us, God's servants, to speak his word. And we need to do that more than anything now. Not only in because of the popular culture, but we need to speak his word as words of faith, as words of condolence, as words of encouragement, and as words of healing during this time of the corona pandemic. Because first of all, we have those who have died, those who have been called home, and we pray for the repose of their souls. That's why the Holy Father included them so poignantly in his plenary indulgence a couple of weeks ago. The family members who are not only grieving the loss of their loved one, but they're grieving the loss that they couldn't be with them. We are giving prayers of empowerment to the medical professionals, to the first responders, to the emergency people, to the doctors and to the scientists and to the nurses and the researchers, so that they can not only serve the suffering humanity now, but they can come up with solutions to end the suffering. We then have words of encouragement that we speak to those who are able, that are volunteering in the community, whether it's the shelters that are filling up here in Denver, whether it's the sandwich lines or the food pantries or the soup and sandwich to go at our mission church at St. Elizabeth, the people who are coming to serve those who are in need. And then finally, words of prayer of healing for those who are suffering from depression, from anxiety, from loneliness, from panic in terms of losing their jobs, with businesses that may not come back when this is all through. So we really want to be enabled to speak God's word in our lives right now, because there are so many people that need to hear it. So in what you do today, on this Monday of the second week of Easter, look around you. Look around you and look at the people that God has placed in your life today. And ask the Holy Spirit to work through you so that you can be able to be enabled to speak the word of God, the word of healing, the word of condolence, the word of encouragement, the word of consolation that they need to hear today. May God bless you. Please stand. Heavenly Father, we offer you all our prayers and our petitions as we pray. For our Holy Father, for the cardinals, the bishops, the priests, the deacons, the seminarians, the consecrated religious, and those contemplating a religious life, for them we pray to the Lord. For our government leaders, for civil servants, and for the military, we pray to the Lord. For our individual communities, our families, our extended families, our friends, our classrooms, our workplaces, and the communities in which we live, for all of them we pray to the Lord. For those who have asked us to pray for them, for those who have no one to pray for them, for the poor souls in purgatory, we pray to the Lord. For refugees and for immigrants, we pray to the Lord. In the spirit of Pope Francis's plenary indulgence, we pray for those who have been called home, their families who mourn, for the first responders, the emergency personnel, the doctors, the nurses, the scientists, the researchers, for the community volunteers, and for those who are sheltered in place who are experiencing loneliness and anxiety. For all of them, we pray to the Lord. For those who are sick, and we remember in a special way the members of our Cathedral and St. Elizabeth community, including Nancy Clark, Jerry Pretty, Bill Johns, Rufus Brown, Peter Chavez, Ron Lair, and Sam Russell. For all of them, we pray to the Lord. For those who have died, and we remember those of our family and extended families in the Cathedral of St. Elizabeth, including Mike Farley, in the repose of his soul and the consolation of his family. For them and for all of those who have been called home, we pray to the Lord. And for those intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we offer you all our prayers and our petitions to act upon according to your providential will. We offer all of them to you through Christ our Lord. Please be seated as we prepare our gifts and we prepare the altar. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Wash me, O Lord, from my iniquities, and cleanse me from my sins. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exalted Church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but at this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. John Paul II, St. Francis Xavier Cabrini, St. Teresa of Calcutta, St. Elizabeth of Hungary, St. Anthony of Padua, St. Francis of Assisi, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Samuel, our Bishop, and Jorge as assistant bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The act of spiritual communion by servant of God Raphael Mary Duval. At thy feet, O my Jesus, I prostrate myself and offer thee repentance of my contrite heart, which is humbled in its nothingness, and in thy holy presence I adore thee in the sacrament of thy love, the ineffable Eucharist. I desire to receive thee into the poor dwelling that my heart offers thee. While waiting for the happiness of sacramental communion, I wish to possess thee in spirit. Come to me, O my Jesus, since I, for my part, am coming to thee. May thy love embrace my whole being in life and in death. I believe in thee, I hope in thee, I love thee. Amen. The communion antiphon. Jesus stood in the midst of his disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you. Alleluia." Please stand. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those who are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord. Well, my sisters and brothers, just a few comments. The first is, I want to thank our team here at the Cathedral Basilica, Bridget Demko, Lisa Butts-Jones, and John Brooks, for the liturgies and the paraliturgies that we've been able to bring to you. Now we have a complete package that's available to you through our social media throughout the day. The daily Mass is available at 7 o'clock in the morning. I would encourage you to do a spiritual communion at 10 o'clock in the morning. The Angelus is available online from us now at noon. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon is the Chaplet of Divine Mercy. And then finally, at 6 o'clock in the evening is the Immaculate Conception Novena, which was developed here. And so we invite you to help that be part of your spiritual life throughout the day, because doing those prayers and those liturgies may give you just the time that you need to hear the Spirit speaking to you and enabling you to live the Spirit in your daily life. Number two, we want to thank all of you who continue to donate food for the meats and the cheeses and the breads for our breakfast sandwich line. Continue to do that because we have not had to pay for the materials for our breakfast sandwich line the last several weeks now, and that's been a great easing of our financial burden. We also want to thank those of you that are volunteering the food for the sandwich and soup to go at our Mission Church St. Elizabeth. We thank you also for those of you that are donating food for our food pantry at 1 o'clock in the afternoon here at the cathedral. And we thank all the volunteers that are helping us make the sandwiches, distribute the sandwiches, distribute the groceries, distribute the lunches to go at St. Elizabeth. So we greatly appreciate all that you're doing to help us. And it's important because, as I've been telling you, through Easter Sunday, the cathedral basilica offertory is down $28,500. St. Elizabeth, about $4,000. We applied and our loan was accepted by the SBA, and then the fund was out of money. So we're in the queue, but right now, in terms of available cash, we have the funds available to get us through the bills the first week in May. And then we depend on your providence. So anything that you can do to help us financially, go to our websites, put a contribution in the mail, or even drop it by during breakfast sandwiches at 8 or the pantry at 1 o'clock during the day. But anything that you can do to help us would be greatly appreciated. And please know that in all we do here, you continue to be in our prayers. And we so much ask the Holy Spirit to work through you to touch the lives of those that God has placed in your care. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace.